There's a couple of bad eggs. But I'm not telling.
Amen, preacher.
All right. Well, it's preaching time.
Amen.
In the book of 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. Thank you, sir. Started verse 1 there, said, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace unto you, and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. So I want to preach today on that. There's a lot of good preaching in that. But I want to preach on the subject of heaven today. Preached last week, if you remember, on the subject of hell. I'm glad that's over with. Glad I don't have to preach that. I would rather preach about heaven anytime.
Amen.
And I want to preach on it today. So you pray for us as we look from in God's Word to try to find out what we need to know about that place called heaven. Father, we thank you for the privilege to pray. We thank you, Lord, for your blessings on our life. We thank you, God, that one day we're going to heaven.
Yes.
Father, we're part of your family, and when our journey's over, we're going home. I pray, Lord, that you'd help us and give us grace. Help us to preach in Jesus' name. Amen. An old song, when I was a boy, in childhood I heard of a heaven, I wondered if it could be true. If there were sweet mansions eternal, I wondered if people really go there. Then one day sweet Jesus came in, and I got a vision of heaven. Amen. My soul throughout heaven was sin. The home of God's people, the home of happiness and joy, the realization of what all that we've struggled with down here, and God's going to make it worth our while.
Amen.
Won't it be good when we get home? I'm glad I'm going. I'm glad that Jesus bought my pardon and gave me a hope of heaven. Heaven is a real place. It's not some never land that's just kind of spiritually floating around, but it's a physical place. If you would put a letter in the mailbox and address it to 171 Branch Road, Witcher, Bell, West Virginia 25015, you'd get to a physical place. You'd get to the address of Esther Baptist Church.
Amen.
If you had a mailman that was capable, he'd bring the letter to the church. What are you saying? I'm saying if we were able to deliver it, there is a physical place.
Amen.
Amen. Got my name on the mansion.
That's right.
One of these days, thank God, I'm going to move in.
Right.
And you say, well, nobody capable of delivering the... Oh, yes, there is.
Yeah.
There's a Savior that has passed into the heavens.
Yeah.
So let's look about the physical aspect of what we're... I hope I can get this explained. Number one, there's three heavens, not seven.
Yeah, right.
You know, the mythology would teach you go to the seventh heaven or whatever, but the Bible actually teaches there's only three, and it enumerates them this way. in the book of Genesis chapter 1 and verse 20, when God made the fowls of the air, when God made the birds, He made them to fly in the open firmament of the heaven. And so the very first heaven is actually the atmosphere around our earth. That's where the birds fly. That's where the rain falls from, according to Deuteronomy chapter 11 and verse 11. That's where we get our weather, our snow and our rain and our sunny days. They all come from that first heaven. Now the second heaven, it goes on beyond that. If you've been part of the school, you know that Psalm chapter 19 verse 1 talks about that second heaven. That's where the stars are. That's the heavens that declare the glory of God.
Amen.
And the firmament that shows His handiwork. That's where the moon and the stars are. You understand what I'm saying? This is kind of laid out in layers. The Bible said in the book of Amos, it was stories, three stories to the way God has built things. Heavens declare the glory of God. The sun makes its circuit through the second heaven. But now this is what we can't grasp. God is outside His creation.
Yeah.
I mean, whenever we study and when the scientists study to try to see how far our universe expands, they look and the bigger their telescope, the more universe there is.
Yeah, right.
But they have to tell us because there is a physical limitation to everything we know. There's got to be a physical limitation to that second heaven. Somewhere you're going to run out.
Yeah.
We haven't run out yet.
Amen.
Billions and billions of miles. But there's somewhere up beyond the stars, amen, that unmanifested manifestation, the glory of God. The Bible said there's a place where light dwells.
Amen.
Job chapter 38 verse 19. The place where light dwells. Now, in that chapter, if you study it, there's 35 questions that's asked of Job right there in that chapter. God asked him questions like this. You're so smart, pal. Where were you when I formed the foundation of the earth, when I laid it? What was you doing then? What is that there, Hawkins, Dawkins, or whatever that goofball is that's the evolutionist man today? Where was he? He's awful big, isn't he?
Yeah.
To go talk about he knows what happened 25 billion years ago. Was he there? He wasn't there.
Amen.
But God was there.
Amen.
And where was you, Job, when I laid the foundation of the earth? The sons of God did something and somebody else did something else. Somebody shouted, somebody sang morning stars. Verse 19. He said, the way where light dwelleth. The way where light dwelleth. Light, watch this. Light doesn't dwell in a place. It dwells in a way. Would you agree with me that light's moving? It's not dwelling anywhere. You would have to say it was dwelling in a way. I said that to say this. In the 14th chapter of the book of John, Jesus said, I am the way.
Yeah.
Jesus also said, I am the light of the world. He's the way where light dwells. Amen.
Amen.
He's the one that keeps things moving.
Yeah.
God dwells in Jesus in the third heaven, that is the paradise of God, according to 2 Corinthians in chapter 12, verse 2. But light does not dwell, it moves. But what Daniel chapter 2, we were just in this in the Sunday school lesson. Light does have a source. Now, I know about these lights here, they have a physical source. But light, not the sunlight, I'm talking about the light of God. It has a source. Can I turn over there and see if I can read that? Again, Daniel chapter 2, you were just there in our Sunday school lesson. Daniel chapter 2. I think I'm going to go to about verse 22. Let me look and see. When Daniel is faced with expounding this king's dream, and you know the story, you know that they were going to kill all the wise men of Babylon, and Daniel said, well, let me go talk to the boss.
Yeah, amen.
And we'll see if we can figure out about this. And look at verse 22. He's talking about his boss when he said, he revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him.
Amen.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Amen.
The source of all light is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I am the light of the world. The light of the world comes from heaven.
Yeah.
In him was light, and there was no darkness at all.
Right.
The light shined in the darkness, but the darkness comprehended it not.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is that heaven is there, but it's incomprehensible to us here today. The promise of God to man is the privilege of dwelling with him. In order for us to comprehend, we need a physical manifestation.
Yeah.
And so if I was going to go for a physical manifestation, I would just describe the New Jerusalem.
Yeah.
He's the light of that city.
Amen.
And he's the place, there's the place that we'll dwell. That is the Father's house.
Yeah.
And in the Father's house are many mansions,
Amen.
The Bible tells
Amen.
Us. And I believe it was Mrs. A.S. Bridgewater that got it right when she penned the words, how beautiful heaven must be.
Yeah.
No drooping, no pining. Amen. No longing for elsewhere to be.
Yeah.
God's light is forever there shining. Pure water's flowing. Rare jewels are glowing. No problem with angels singing by the crystal sea. Sweet chords from their gold harps are ringing.
Amen.
How beautiful heaven must be.
Amen.
Fair haven of rest for the weary. Heaven is a real place.
Amen.
And I'm going there one of these days. Let me say number two, that heaven has a real king.
Amen.
And that king is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He's not only the king of Israel. He's not only the king of the Jews. But in the book of Revelation, we find out that he's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In Revelation 15:3, it says he's the King of Saints. Now, he did not hold that office while he was on earth. In a physical sense, he's never held that office yet. But one of these days, he's going to take over the kingdoms of this world. One day that stone's going to roll down through Babylon and tear down the kingdoms of this world. He was born a king. He was anointed a king, but he never did take that office of king. I remember a story about that in the book of 1 Samuel, wasn't it? That David was anointed a king, but it was a long time of rejection and a hunted and a despised and rejected of men. But one day, he got the crown, and one day he came into his own as the king of Jerusalem. Now, his parallel is to the coronation of Jesus Christ. I believe it at that feastal ceremony when they crown him Lord of all. I think I'll get to see it.
Amen.
I'll be there. That'll be my king.
Amen.
He's the rightful king. That's the goal that God has for all of earth. While he was on earth, he was a prophet.
Yes.
He's not a king now. He's a priest now.
Right.
If he was operating as a king, you and I'd be in trouble.
Yeah, amen.
But he's operating as a priest.
Yeah.
To make intercession for you and me. To keep us saved.
Amen.
If it wasn't for his intercessory work, we would not be saved today. Christians couldn't go if it wasn't for the fact that we've got a advocate
Amen.
With the Father, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He's a propitiation for our sins.
Amen.
Right now, he's a priest. One day soon, he'll be the King of Kings
Amen.
And Lord of Lords.
Amen.
Now, let me digress just a little bit. The church is a spiritual entity. I mean, it's spoken of, whenever you find it in the Gospels, it's spoken of as a mystery kingdom form. That there is a way that Christ is, in a sense that Christ is a king. Not in a physical sense, but in a spiritual sense. Now, I don't believe in lordship salvation. I don't want to make you mad, but I don't believe in lordship salvation. I believe in grace salvation.
Amen.
I believe you're saved by grace. But I do believe in lordship Christianity.
Amen.
And I believe unless you can make Jesus the Lord of your life, you'll be one miserable Christian.
Amen.
Imagine your heart as a throne. And imagine that inside your spirit, that you've got the opportunity to either allow the king to rule it or rule it yourself.
Yeah.
Is that what goes on in our life?
Yeah,
and imagine that whenever we're on the throne, Jesus is in the gutter.
Yeah.
Amen. When he's on the throne,
amen,
we're in the gutter.
Amen.
Amen. As far as decisions are concerned, yes, he is the King of Kings, and he's our King today, and we need to obey him today. In heaven, with the curse of indwelling sin, it'll be removed, and we'll follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. He'll still be our King. There'll be no more curse. The throne of God and the Lamb will be there, and his servants will serve him. We'll serve him because he's our King. The reason you don't serve him is because you don't see him as a king.
Amen.
Amen. You see him as a spare tire.
Yeah.
You don't see him as royalty.
Yeah.
You see him as a fire escape. But brother, when you get a hold of what I'm preaching today, you'll see that Jesus Christ has every right to present our body a living sacrifice to him.
Amen.
That would be acceptable. That would be a reasonable service. Heaven's a place. Heaven's a real place. And heaven's got a real king. Then let me tell you that heaven's got a real citizenship record. A real citizenship roll. Heaven's got a roll. And when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Heaven's got a roll. It is called right now the book of life. One of these days when everything is said and done, the assembly of the glory land is over, then it'll be called the Lamb's Book of Life. That's another sermon, but what I'm saying, that there is a roll book in heaven.
Yeah.
I believe that the local church is God's church.
Yeah.
I don't believe in Randy Wilson's church.
Amen.
I don't believe in Deacon Hoy's church.
Amen.
Or Deacon Sparks' church.
Yeah.
I believe in God's church.
Amen.
And I believe God's church ought to be set up the same way that heaven's set up.
Amen.
And if heaven's got a role, I believe the church ought to have a role.
Amen.
And I believe he ought to pay you to get your name on it.
Amen.
You say, show that to me in the book. I'm glad you asked, man. Turn to the book of Acts chapter 1. I get preaching and I can't find my places. Acts chapter 1. I'm saying the local church is to be set up as a miniature heaven. And if heaven has a role, then the church ought to have a role. In Acts chapter 1 verse 14, they all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, now look at that parenthesis. The number of names together were about 120. They had a record of 120 names.
Amen.
On the roll of the church of Jerusalem.
Amen.
There's a record here. Somebody, they ask me all the time, how big's your church? I said, that there's a very, very hard to define question. Are you asking how many's on the roll, or are you asking how many attended Sunday, or are you asking how many attended Wednesday? If you want to know how many's on the roll, I can pull a roll out. We got 300 members. Amen. Do you believe that?
I can show it to you. We got it. I got a roll book that says 300 members. Now, how big's your church, preacher? Look around. Seems to me like we're missing a few.
Yeah, amen.
I'm sure they're all in the nursery. But nevertheless, heaven is to be set up as the church is set up as a miniature heaven. That's what it's supposed to be. Coming to church is supposed to be good for you.
Amen.
Coming to church is supposed to be fun. You're supposed to smile.
Amen.
I mean, you're not supposed to come to church and look like that the mew eat every corn you had in your garden.
Yeah.
You're supposed to come with a smile on your face.
Amen.
I mean, I get so sick of hearing about them Baptist churches fighting with one another.
Yeah.
They can't get along with one another down here. How are they going to get along in heaven? I'm glad that I get to go to church. I like to go to church.
Amen.
I do. I like to go. I'll go to drop a hat. Of course, it's getting harder. It's not getting harder spiritually. It's getting harder physically. Amen. And I mean, you know, there's just so much you can do with an ugly fat guy. I like what that little girl was sitting on her mommy's lap, and mommy was kind of plump, you know, and she looked up at him. She said, "Mommy," said, you're the prettiest fat girl I ever saw." And mommy said, "Oh, how could you say that, honey?" Said, "Now don't you understand that I'm just ugly and I'm just fat?" She said, No. Said, "You're fat, but you ain't ugly." Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. All right, listen. I'm saying that there is a roll call in glory. And when the roll is called, I'm planning on being there. There is a requirement before you get your name on a church roll. Amen. There is a requirement that you be baptized in water before you get your name on a church roll. There is a requirement that you be baptized by the Holy Ghost before you can get your name on the roll of glory. Greek scholars talk about that preposition, E-I-S. That's an English spelling. It can be translated a multitude of different ways, and they always fussing about it. It always comes up, you know, whether you should translate it in, or whether you should translate it by, or whether you should translate it with. So when we're talking about sometimes, you know, if you got a real good Baptist, he'll say, "Well, you need to be baptized with water." Another one will say, "Well, no, you need to be baptized in water." Then another one say, "No, you need to be baptized by water." Amen. And then they do the same thing with the Holy Ghost. They'll say, "Well, you need to be baptized with the Holy Ghost." "No, you need to be baptized by the Holy Ghost." "No, you need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost." And the truth of the matter is, you need all three of them.
Yeah,
amen. So let's just get in all over.
Yeah.
Amen. Quit worrying about what some little Greek word means, and let's do what God tells us to do. Heaven has a role, a real role. And when a name is called, I believe we'll answer.
Yeah.
You say, "When will the name be called?" I'm glad you asked. I'll tell you that too. At the rapture of the church,
right,
I believe that every Christian will hear their name.
Amen.
Amen. Whenever he calls, I believe. You say, "How could that?" We're talking about God. We're not talking
Amen.
About you. We're talking about my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. They hear, they know I'm talking to them. When I holler, "Lazarus, come forth," they know who I'm talking to. And whenever the rapture day comes and he hollers, "Randy, come out of there," I'll know who he's talking to. Malachi chapter 3 verse 16. There's a book of remembrance that was written, and God said those that spoke often together one another said, "They'll be mine when I make up my jewels." Heaven's a real place. It's got a real king. It's got a real role. It's got a real requirement if you're to go there. Real reservations must be made. Price got to be paid. You ever get one of those deals that says prepaid?
Yeah.
The price was prepaid by Jesus Christ. He made the necessary arrangements. He made the reconciliation to God. It was made by the shedding of His blood on the cross of Calvary. The only way that any of us could ever get to glory would be because the price was paid. Our ticket was bought through the Lord Jesus Christ. The Old Testament priest would lay his hands on the scapegoat. Ceremonially, he'd transfer his sins from himself to the scapegoat. Then he'd take the blood of that slain within the veil and sprinkle it seven times on the mercy seat before the eyes of God. And Jesus fulfilled all that and has become our propitiation and our ticket to heaven. You gotta have a ticket.
Amen.
Was that the Calvaryman's old song? Y'all remember that? You ain't got no ticket, you can't ride.
Amen.
And one of them hold up that book, said, I got my ticket. Amen. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go to glory because my ticket's been stamped, paid, prepaid by the Lord Jesus Christ. Got to have a ticket. The third chapter of Zechariah, the Bible talks about Joshua the high priest standing before the Lord, clothed in filthy garments, filthy rags. That's what I was clothed in. I was standing there in my filth. But then one member of the Trinity said to the other member of the Trinity, the Lord said to my Lord, the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuked thee. Boy, that there would bear some study.
Yep.
One member of the Trinity didn't rebuke him. He said to the other member, rebuke you.
Yeah.
I'll let y'all figure that out. But anyway, because of that statement, that filthy garments were taken off of him. And a new robe, a clean robe was donned. Not only did he get to wear a clean robe, but he got a crown to put on his head. Amen. And made him look presentable before the Father. We work for Christ, not because we have to get saved, but because we love him and are grateful for what he's done. And there is nothing done for Jesus that will not be rewarded. No good deed will go unrewarded. God is going to see to it. If you give a cup of cold water, God's got that recorded, and you'll be rewarded for that. There's one aspect of reward that speaks about crowns when we get to heaven. There is a crown for keeping our flesh in check. Did you ever have problems with your flesh?
Amen.
Did it ever want to do things that you knew were a violation of the Scripture?
Amen.
The Bible said that those heathens, they keep their body in subjection so that they can obtain a corruptible crown. But in the 1 Corinthians chapter 9, and the Apostle Paul said, I keep mine in subjection that I might be able to gain an incorruptible crown. Amen. So you go ahead and live after the flesh. I'm telling you what, man, if you'll keep it in subjection, God will reward you for doing that very thing.
Amen.
Wouldn't that be good?
Yes.
Well, I won't go any further with that. I'll just say that next, there's a crown for winning people to Jesus. God loves people, and God loves to see them saved.
Amen.
In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 19, if you can get them saved, you'll get a crown for doing it.
Amen.
It'll be worth your while. There's a soul winner's crown. There's a crown for expectancy.
Amen.
And I've preached that to you. The Bible said that Paul said there's a crown laid up for me, and not for me only, but to all those that love his appearing. Would it be good with you if Jesus was to come name?
Amen.
Hey, would you like that? Amen. Some folks say, well, I'd like to get to the house and throw away them dirty videos. Amen. If I could get that beer out of my refrigerator before. Hey, I'd like for him to come right now. Amen. Thank you. There's a reward for expectancy, a reward in the glory land. There is a reward for enduring temptation. I hate temptation.
Amen.
I really do. I can walk by a pizza. And you know, I got a pretty good bit of willpower. I can go 2 or 3, 4 or 5 days and not eat a thing. But some, when I take that first bite, chomp, 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 I'll eat everything I can get a hold of. And I assure y'all don't have that problem. But if you endure temptation, there's a crown.
Amen.
For enduring. And I use that so y'all could laugh at me. But if I'd expose yours, I'd be laughing at you.
Amen.
There's a pastor's crown.
Yeah.
Amen. You don't have to be a pastor to win it. You can be a Sunday school teacher and win it. Pastor's a shepherd. That's somebody that looks after somebody. Amen. You look at somebody. You know, in my way of thinking, there's a special gift of looking after people.
Yeah, amen.
I appreciate folks that are able to go and sit with sick people or old people, people that's been abandoned by society.
And
you know what I'm talking about? Some people just go in there and just make their day bright.
Yeah. Amen.
I think there's a crown for that. There's a martyr's crown. There's a church member's crown, Philippians chapter 4, verse 2. We will be rewarded in heaven.
Amen.
That's what I'm preaching. I'm preaching about heaven.
Amen.
In heaven, we'll be rewarded for the things we're persecuted for here. The times we've been lied on here, we'll be rewarded in heaven for. Talked about down here. Rejoice, he said. Great is your reward in heaven. Rewarded for loving people. Rewarded for secret service. Rewarded for cups of water. Reward is personal. One plants, another waters, but we're rewarded, everyone, according to his own labor. Heaven. A real place. Got a real king. Got a real role. Got a real ticket. And got a real reward when you get there. You want to go? Got to have reservations. Ever walk into a motel in a strange city, a hotel in a strange city? You walk up to the desk and say, have you got a room? They say, have you got a reservation? If you got a reservation, come on in. You ain't got no reservation. They handle you a totally different way, don't they? Well, rooms just went up. If you had a reservation, it was $150. You ain't got no reservation, it's $250. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, you got a reservation?
Yes.
Up in heaven, do you remember what we read? An inheritance, undefiled, reserved in heaven for you. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. Let's bow for prayer.